Who stuffed that white owl? No one spoke in the shop. The barber was busy and he couldn't stop. The customers waiting their turns were all reading the Daily, the Herald, the Post, little heeding the young man who blurted out such a blunt question. No one raised a head or even made a suggestion. And the barber kept on shaving. "Don't you see, Mr. Brown," cried the youth with a frown, "how wrong the whole thing is? How preposterous each wing is, how flattened the head is, how jammed down the neck is. In short, the whole owl, what an ignorant wreck 'tis. I make no apology, I've learned owl-eology. I've passed days and nights in 100 collections, and cannot be blinded to any deflections arising from unskillful fingers that fail to stuff a bird right from his beak to his tail. Mr. Brown, Mr. Brown, do take that bird down, or you'll soon be the laughing stock all over town." And the barber kept on shaving. "I've studied owls and other night fowls, and I tell you what I know to be true. An owl cannot roost with his limbs so unloosed. No owl in this world ever had his claws curled, ever had his legs slanted, ever had his bill canted, ever had his neck screwed into that attitude. He can't do it, because 'tis against all bird laws. Anatomy teaches, ornithology preaches, an owl has a toe that can't turn out so. I've made the white owl my study for years, and to see such a job almost moves me to tears. Mr. Brown, I'm amazed you should be so gone crazed as to put up a bird in that posture absurd. To look at that owl really brings on a dizziness. The man who stuffed him doesn't half know his business." And the barber kept on shaving. "Examine those eyes. I'm filled with surprise taxidermists should pass off to you such poor glass. So unnatural they seem, they'd make Audubon scream and John Burroughs laugh to encounter such chaff. Do take that bird down. Have him stuffed again, Brown." And the barber kept on shaving. "With some sawdust and bark, I could stuff in the dark an owl better than that. I could make an old hat look more like an owl than that horrid fowl, stuck up there so stiff like a side of coarse leather. In fact, about him, there's not one natural feather." Just then, with a wink and a sly, normal lurch, the owl very gravely got down from his perch, walked round and regarded his fault-finding critic, who thought he was stuffed, with a glance analytic, and then fairly hooted, as if he should say, "Your learning's at fault this time, anyway. Don't waste it again on a live bird, I pray. I'm an owl, you're another. Sir Critic, good day." And the barber kept on shaving.